Good morning, everyone, and welcome once again on behalf of Predictive Homeopathy to the Sadhana series, lecture number 22. We are here again to continue whatever the sharing has been done by Dr. Praful Vijaykar, sir. Starting with the slide which gives us the blessings from our master, Dr. Samuel Hahnemann. Then seeking blessings from our guru, Dr. Praful Vijaykar sir, because of which Predictive Homeopathy is into existence, and we all are here to share whatever knowledge he has left behind us. And I'm very sure that sir is still looking at us. He is imparting his knowledge and his wisdom to all of us, so that homeopathy can grow to the best and we can heal the patients with the best of the treatment. Let's go ahead with the book that has been going into run, End of the Maya Assumptions. As we finished in the last chapter, it was about the connect between the miasms and the genetic trait, how they are connected to each other. We start ahead now with chapter 14. Having established connections between genetic trait and miasms, we proceed to understand individual miasmatic constitutions. We have three different miasmatic constitutions as described. They are the soric constitution, the psychotic constitution, and the syphilitic constitution. Going ahead with the soric constitutions, individuals born with predominantly soric constitutions have an innate and predominant tendency to fight all the invasions, whether they are pathogens, toxins, or mental plane, the emotions, by that may whatever the pathogens or the external influence which is going to be there on the vital force. Individuals which are born with soric tendencies and soric constitutions will always respond predominantly a very, very physiological defensive response in the form of inflammations. These people are bound to get easy inflammations, easy irritations, easy infection, easy pains or hypersensitiveness as far as physical diseases are concerned. So that is what, that the soric constitution will always implement the first mechanism of defense, that is with the help of inflammation. The body will always try to resolve and to defend with whatever pathogen or the toxin has affected, with giving its response in the form of inflammation. So we will have all the diseases which are there in the body, which will be there on the skin layers or on the tonsils or the bronchus, but in the form of inflammation. Patients who get dermatitis, rhinitis, tonsillitis, bronchitis, at the slightest provocation, example, change of food, weather, emotions, are soric constitutions. These diseases, as we know, predominate in young age groups. Thus, sora is evident more in infants, children, and less in middle age or old age. So that is what, you know, a certain deviation in our lifestyle or just a change in the food. For example, if we have a little of a cold or an ice cream or something, but the immediate reaction, the immediate defense of the body will be in the form of an inflammation, that is maybe either tonsillitis or bronchitis, or even if there is change of weather, the patient may just come down with cold coryza and nothing much more deeper, because that itself will take care. The constitution is such, it is, the vital force is so strong enough that even taking care of the vital force will be done by the first defense mechanism, that is inflammation itself. Thus, the sora is more evident in more of an infants, because the vitality is very good, and that is why in infants, children, and less in middle age and old age. Those who have inherited physiological defense or SORA in their genes do not shift gears easily to morphological defense, psychosis, or syphilis. Already when the vitality is strong enough, the pathogen, the shift of the gaze will not happen very easily to psychosis or syphilis. The body will always try to continue it with the help of giving just a soric defense so that the pathogen is thrown away and the vital force regains itself to health. In such constitutions, suppression do not take place easily from one miasm to the other. The disease may travel from one system to another. See the chart of suppression in the book Theory of Suppression, which we have already taken earlier, but retain its expression as irritation or inflammation. Soric individuals show dermatitis or boils in skin, that is a first layer involvement, being converted into pharyngitis, that is a second layer. A bronchitis disappearing or an asthma getting relieved by partial simulima may show up as arthritis or spondylitis, the third layer. So herein it is described, Sir very clearly says that whenever a physiological defense is occurring, there can be a shift in the another system or on another layer, but the defense mechanism will be in the form of inflammation itself. And this is so strong enough that the body's gear will not immediately shift to either psychosis or syphilis. He has given examples as if there is dermatitis or there are boils on the skin. Some injury, some trauma to the skin has happened. The body has reacted as an inflammation. There is dermatitis. And by some means, either the patient has applied some ointment or taken some medications or even some homeopathic treatment where there is a partial simulima which has acted, the layer, the system may change, but the form of defense will always be in the form of inflammation. A sciatica, a spondylitis, or joint pain disappearing by partial simulimum could result in volatile hypertension or stress hypertension or ischemic heart disease, which is characterized by what the cardiologists call as unstable angina. So the partial simulimum may act, the layer or the system may change, and the patient may come down with a volatile hypertension. Again, it will be a physiological defense. So there is no structural change that has happened in the blood vessels or something. It's just that there is a physiological change, a spasm of the blood vessels, and that may just cause volatile hypertension, or for that matter, the coronary arteries go into a temporary spasm. There will be constriction and spasmodic actions which are taking place, but there is no structural change. There is no cholesterol or any other constructive change which has happened into the blood vessels. So it will immediately come back to the normal phenomena, and that is why it is called an unstable angina. The unstable word itself means that it is not stable. It is just a physiological and a temporary change which the vital force has made so that the body can survive and it can defend whatever the outside trauma has happened. The unstable angina, as the name suggests, has instability, which is associated with biochemical changes in the intima of the arteries. The soric ischemia or lack of blood supply to heart is due to spasmodic constriction of the blood vessels rather than any concrete structural obstruction associated with arteriosclerosis, which is the origin into psychosis. So that constructive change has still not happened. It is still only the physiological change which will regain back after the trauma has been removed or the simulimum has acted to the best. So herein it is very clear that whatever the shift of the layer of the system is there, that will happen only on a temporary phase, and it's a physiological defense by which the vital force can take care of the trauma and the disease can be removed and then patient can regain back to health. The physiological nature of defense caused due to sheer biochemical changes in cells and tissue offers a sense of fluidity, changeability, and or instability to psoriatic symptoms, which can best be termed as high dynamism. There is a lot of dynamicity. There is a lot of activity which happens, and there is continuous change which is happening. So it is called as dynamic. And so the tissue and the cells will offer a different kind of a reaction, as in there is a some changeability. There is an instability for a temporary period, after which when the vital force regains its originality, the psoriatic defense is enough for the body to come back to the homeostasis. The symptoms of psora, therefore, will essentially be of sudden onset of paroxysmality or intensify of pains or redness with changeability, and do respond to treatment and is associated with very fast recovery. So that is what happens, that most of the times they may be the acute diseases that we see, and here in medicines like aconite or belladonna, which are indicated. We can see, for example, even if there is tonsillitis, say from having some food which is not suitable, and the symptoms will be there, but there will be a temporary phase. There will be sudden rise of fever, there will be redness, the throat, there will be pain, and these symptoms will be dynamic, so that the intensity looks very high, but there is an ailment from, there is a physiological change that is seen, no structural change has happened. And after the medicine or after giving the simulimum, the recovery comes at a very fast pace. And that is why it is understood that this is a psoriatic constitution. And when we understand that such a person or a personality is having this kind of a defense, they are the psoriatic constitutions, and wherein always the reaction will always be there in the form of an inflammatory process, which itself will take care, and no further psychosis or syphilis will set in. You may just understand here that the primary defense is always physiological, wherein there is some biochemical changes on a physiological level. The inflammation takes place, and it responds in the form of irritability, hypersensitivity, or hyposensitivity. And what we can understand in general about the psoriatic constitution that we spoke is that psoriatic constitutions, the physiological defense responses in the form of inflammations, example for change of food or change of weather or emotional triggers, will lead to inflammatory processes like dermatitis, rhinitis, tonsillitis, gastritis, etc. Even if there is suppression in such cases by partial simulimum, it will be psoriatic. Like diseases will change the system or layer, but the psoriatic manifestation will prevail. Example as given, dermatitis in the first layer on the skin may get converted to pharyngitis in the second layer, but it is still in the inflammatory form and it has not gone into a constructive change. Bronchitis converting to arthritis or spondylitis in the third layer. Next we have is the psychotic constitutions. Individuals born with predominantly psychotic constitution have an innate and predominant tendency to fight all the invasions, whether they are pathogens, toxins, or on mental plane, the emotions by constructive defense response of the cell and the tissue. These people are bound to get easy constructions, easy growths, thickenings, tumors, chronic non-resolving inflammations. Herein, it is very clearly understood that psychotic constitution are such wherein the defense mechanism, the psoriatic inflammatory response, has not been able to remove the disease out of the body, and then the vital force, the body's health, the body's doctor starts taking the constructive form of defense, which is the psychotic miasm, which comes into play, and these are called the psychotic constitutions. Herein we will very clearly visualize that whenever an injury or a trauma is there, an initial inflammation takes place, but after which the body doesn't resolve, and then it needs to go into the second gear, which is a constructive type of a defense mechanism, and wherein the psychosis sets in. So people or the patients will start showing the responses in the form of easy growths or thickenings or tumors, or there are inflammatory diseases which don't resolve for a long time, and they go from an acute to a chronic phase, and that continues. So when a patient comes to you, at times we find children or the middle-aged persons who have these tendencies of getting thickening of the fingers, the skin over the fingers, or wherever there is pressure coming continuously, we will see that the thickening of the skin starts happening, and that gives an indication to us as a physician when we are observing that this personality has this tendency of going into growths or thickenings, and hence we can understand that the psychotic constitution is the one that we are dealing with. In serious diseases like diabetes, high blood pressures, anemias, hyperlipidemias, ischemias are common at an early age. These are some of the diseases which is the psychotic defense of the body. Now, after the inflammatory processes, the example that we gave of angina or the volatile hypertension, that has not been able to withstand and the disease is still progressing, either the cause is maintained or the body is weak enough that it cannot take care by only the psoric defense, it starts going into the constructive thing, and wherein there is deposition of fats and lipids into the blood vessels, and they go on with high blood pressures and hyperlipidemias and diabetes, and so in the psychotic diseases now will start setting in. Warts, moles, keloids thrown up externally gives us an indication that the patient has entered the psychotic defense stage. So that's what, whenever there is an injury, if the injury heals, if it is very neat and clean and it heals down with a very, very thin, normal kind of a skin, that's a psoric kind of an healing that happens. But when we find that there is thickening over the sutures which have happened, there is a keloid formation, that gives us an indication that here it is healing with an extra growth, with the overgrowth, and that is forming a keloid. So this type of constitutions will follow into the psychotic constitutions. Patient get primary inflammation and go into constructive pathology very easy. Wounds and injuries are deceptive, never clean cut, nor do they heal. Neatly and cleanly like the psoric constitutions. They are deep inside and concealed with yellow or green colored discharges. Deposition of pigments, hence blackening of skin or wounds, is a rule in this miasm. These diseases, as we know, predominate the middle age groups. So what happens is that after the healing has taken place, we can see that the wound which is there, the injury which is there, has edges which are thickened around, and they are very deceptive. Outside we feel that it may be healed, but inside they are still deep going on. And the injuries and the healing which happens in the wounds will not be neat and clean and tidy as it happens in a psoric constitution. There will be unclear edges, and there will be the dirty looking injuries and wounds. So they will have an yellow or green kind of discharges. Again, there is melanocytes which are deposited to the excess, giving rise to blackening of the skin. And this is a rule, sort of a rule, because when such injuries are seen in the patients and the patient's response is seen, we can very well understand that yes, already the psychotic kind of a defense has started to prevail into this kind, this person or the patient who has come. So what happens is the secondary defense, that is the morphological or the constructive change, has started to happen. The hostile stimulus continues. The cell feels fragile. The cell defends itself by strengthening in the form of accumulation or multiplication, and that is what is the soric kind of a defense. And this happens in the soric in the psychotic constitutions. Just to summarize, psychotic constitutions are morphological defense responses in the form of construction. So they show easy constructions like growth, thickening, tumors, chronic non-resolving inflammations. They develop insidious diseases like diabetes, hypertension, anemias, hyperlipidemia, ischemia at very early age. So we can see that a middle age group people where the psychosis is set in very fast, and the patient has started, the blood reports will show us clearly that the cholesterol levels are high, the triglycerides are high, and the blood pressure has started shooting. Patient has already come with diabetes. Externally, we can find that the indications are given by the body in the form of warts and moles and keloids and etc. Thick discharges and dirty looking wounds, injuries with yellow greenish discharge and extra pigmentation will be seen. Now we go to the syphilitic constitutions. Individuals born with predominantly syphilitic constitutions have an innate or predominant tendency to fight all the invasions, whether they are pathogens, toxins, or on a mental plane, the emotions, by destructive defensive responses of the cell and the tissues. These people are bound to get easy destructions, easy hemorrhages, easy overwhelming infections, septicemias, excruciating pains, hysterical hypersensitivities, fractures that are complex, cracks and ulcers that bleed easily as far as physical diseases are concerned. So there are certain individuals wherein the response of the body is in a destructive pattern always. The first gear and the second gear has not helped that personality to heal and come back to the original health, and that syphilitic trait, that syphilitic type of defense of a destructive pattern has started to set in into that individual. And we see that when they come, they are the complaints also they come with would be that a female may be coming out with the complaint as if a lot of heavy bleeding is there, there are profuse menses, there are lots of clots. And at the same time, we can also see that destructive tendencies such as the cracks and ulcers which are forming, they are deep and they are bleeding ulcers, they do not heal, and the edges of the ulcers are very irregular. They are not very soothing to look at as an ulcer. It really looks very ugly kind of an ulcer. So these indications will make us understand that yes, this is a constitution that we are dealing which is into syphilitic type of a constitution. Patients get primary inflammation and go into the destructive pathology very easily. A wound simply happening may not always bleed to the extent for everybody, but for that individual the bleeding is to a great extent, or the tendency for a small boil or an abscess to get converted into suppurative type of the diseases will be very, very high. And that makes us understand that yes, what we are dealing is with the syphilitic type of a constitution. Wounds are never clean cut, nor do they heal neatly and cleanly like soric constitutions. Distortion and disfigurement is a rule in this miasm. These diseases, as we know, predominate old age groups. Thus, sora is evident from more in infants, children, psychosis in middle age, and syphilis in the old age. So what is seen is that the wounds, as I described just, that they are very dirty looking, never clean cut. The edges are also very irregular and not very clean, as they are seen into the psoric constitutions. And the diseases of these kind moreover prevail into the older age group. Disorder in defense results in destruction. Any destruction is in the form of distortion, perversion, abnormality, and ugliness. All this in mind and body implies syphilis. So there is a kind of a tendency which gives rise to distortion and disfigurement. The normal which is there starts becoming abnormal. And this is a very, very hallmark sign of the syphilitic constitution. At the level of the body and the mind, we will be able to see that the syphilis kind of the miasm has started to set in. So the third defense is at the cost of function of the defense, apolysis, apoptosis, and necrosis or destruction of the disease part, that the whole part survives. So what happens is, now that the body has understood that the psoric miasm or the psoric kind of a defense, which is inflammatory, the psychotic kind of a defense, which is constructive, is not working, and for the vital force to survive and take care of the whole body, some part has to be lost, and then it will be a selection that the less important organ is always sacrificed to save the whole part. And that is the, we are talking about the syphilitic constitution. Now the question arises that why is it important for the physician to know whether the patient is belonging to the psoric kind of a constitution, psychotic kind of a constitution, or a syphilitic kind of constitution. It is very, very important because it gives us a guideline as to what we are dealing with, and in the further follow-ups, what is predicted. We can predict that yes, when such a medicine will be given to a syphilitic kind of a constitution, what kind of a response from the body will be expected. It also helps us to understand the remedy that we have to choose. We have to look for such deep-seated acting or deep-seated remedy which will take care of such a syphilitic kind of a trait that pervades into the body. Unless and until these constitutions are not understood well, the physician will not have that kind of a tool in his hand which will be helpful in the form of a remedy that we are going to choose. A psoric constitution may not require at times so deep acting, and just a few superficial acting remedies may take care of the whole situation. To summarize, we have syphilitic constitutions. The defense response is in the form of destructions. There are easy destructions, overwhelming infections, septicemia, excruciating pains, hysterical hypersensitiveness. These kind of syphilitic traits are seen. A patient going into septicemic shocks, there are hysterical kind of a behavior. Now hysteria abnormality, hysteria itself means that it is abnormal. Something which is not normal is hysterical kind of a behavior. So that kind of a hypersensitiveness is seen. A patient or a normal person may not react so, as that personality is responding, which is hysterical. So that should be there into our back of the mind that yes, a syphilitic trait is lurking in here, and we need to take care of that. And if that is picked up from the observations that we have, we will have something which is very, very important to choose and select the remedy, and that will give us a better kind of a treatment for the patient. Suppurating tendencies, hemorrhages, untidy, irregular edges of wounds, very dirty offensive discharges, complex fractures, cracks, non-healing ulcers. These all fall into the syphilitic trait and type of constitution. Distortion and disfigurement is like a rule and hallmark, and the psoriatic disease tend to go easily in syphilis in such patients. So that's what, that even a small wound which may not cause such a lot of bleeding or it may not go so deep will go to that extent in such syphilitic constitutions, and even it will take time to heal, whereas it may just end up into a non-healing kind of a wound which may convert into a ulcer further. Few example maybe that we can understand is reaction of different miasmatic constitutions. Just an example given, that anger suppressed is a trauma or is an incident which has occurred. A psoriatic kind of a personality may just go into gastritis, and it will get healed very fast with a fast recovery with a very superficial acting remedy. Maybe aconite, belladonna or nux vomica will be able to help and the gastritis will heal. The psychotic personalities, the psychotic constitutions may have this gastritis continued for a long time, going to chronic gastritis or chronic hepatitis, and the ulcers will form into a syphilitic kind of a constitution which will take a while to heal and a deep acting remedy will be required. Similarly, if there is an injury or a trauma in the kind of a fright or shock, a psoriatic person may just have fever and may go into bronchitis, which can be taken care of very easily. But any other person who is of a psychotic trend which is there will land up into pneumonia, and still a further reaction of the body in a syphilitic form would be that it may go into a bronchofistulary pneumonia, bronchofistulary pneumonia. Wonderful case is described by Sir. We will see that. A child of 5 months come with a chief complaint of blindness. The child, not smiling, was diagnosed as blind since birth. The mother insisted that the child used to smile and respond very well to her beckoning until the age of 3 months. She refused to believe the diagnosis of birth defect. On inquiry, it was found that the child was vaccinated at the age of 3 months. The child had a mild rash on the body, after which some cough and cold persisted for a few days, which was better after treatment. There was no other major problem after that. Generally, with due respect to the pediatricians, diagnosis of congenital health problems like diabetes, blindness, autism, mutism, cerebral palsy, epilepsy, etc. should not be relied upon and should be taken with a pinch of salt. Sir is very clearly saying that we physicians should always be alert, and we have to always rely on our own observations, the reports that we have, and the mother or the relative who is describing, rather than just relying on whatever the previous diagnosis is done. Our part has to be played, and we should confirm the diagnosis by these prevailing understandings. So herein, the mother is clearly saying that my child wasn't blind from birth because it was responding to whatever my reactions were there, the stimulus was there, and after the vaccination it was seen that this change has started happening. The mother's observation about the child being normal or abnormal is more reliable. The modern day physician does not have thorough knowledge of what harm can the modern therapeutic drugs do to the young child. They are blissfully unaware of the destructive effects of multitudes of vaccination that cause havoc in the child's immunity. We have been seeing ample number of times that post vaccination there is a lot of change, or there is a kind of a disease pattern that is set into a child. It is left on us as physicians to be very, very alert and to be very, very unprejudiced, to keep our mind and eyes open to understand that yes, vaccination is one of the factors which can be the ailments from after which the disease has set in. Nor are they aware of mild, seemingly benign eruptions on the skin metastasizing into epilepsy or tumors. It has been very, very clearly seen, and abrodenum is one of the remedies which we see wherein it helps in such kind of cases, that post-vaccination there were eruption on the skin, and when they were treated, patient or the child has gone into epilepsy or tumors. In this child, the vaccination had set up a series of chain reactions in the body which ended up as degeneration of the retina. So this is one thing that we need to understand. This one behavior of the child's body should make us understand and alert that yes, what we are dealing here is with a syphilitic kind of a constitution. The child's constitution belongs to this, because just the vaccination or the eruption on the skin was suppressed, and what it has led to is something on a very, very higher level as the degeneration of the retina. So herein we have to connect, and we have to see that yes, what we are dealing with is a kind of a syphilitic constitution. The child was a strong syphilitic constitution, and hence after the initial psoriasis-physiological defense reaction on the skin, the genes were forced to change the gear of defense to destructive defense at the level of neuroectoderm, that is the retina, and that too in a short period of 1 month. So from the ectoderm, it has directly gone into the neuroectoderm. So there is pace which is very fast, and there is the shift of layers which is very fast, and there was no psychosis in between. The directly the ectoderm has gone to the neuroectoderm. The psora directly went into a syphilitic kind of a presentation instead of entering to the mesoderm, indicating a remedy which does not follow the rules or with a hysterical trait. The remedy had to be fast in speed, looking at the speed with which the disease had progressed. Therefore, a destructive, syphilitic, fast, revolting, chilly and thirsty remedy, which is badly influenced by bad effects of vaccination, was selected, and that was mercurial salt. So this understanding of the three types of different constitution allows us to make a proper totality in a holistic way, that yes, if this kind of a reaction is seen wherein the psora immediately got traveled to the syphilitic type of a reaction, then this fast, this kind of a speedy reaction in the body has to be there in the remedy also that we select, which also has to be such deep acting. It has to be a syphilitic kind of a remedy, and again it has to be there, which is a very fast progressive, and wherein the selection of mercurial salt was done by sir. Herein we end the three different type of constitutions very well described by sir, and that was on the physical or the material part. Now we can go ahead with the part two, that is our journey through material body, which is over, and we enter the mind, the cell and the miasm. Entering the mind of the cell. In aphorism 63 of Organon, Hahnemann mentions that every agent and every medicine deranges the vital force and causes alteration in health for longer or shorter period. Vital force endeavors to oppose it. This resistant action is a property or automatic action of our life for preserving power. What is being spoken here is that every agent or every medicine which has the capacity to derange the vital force, and it will cause some alteration into the health for either a short period of a time or a longer period of a time. But at the same time, the original intelligence of the vital force is always there to oppose this kind of, injury which is happening to the body. And for this, it is resisting its action in a property or automatic action of our life preserving power. It means that the vital force of the force which is there inside the cells and the tissues both as a whole being, the intelligence of itself will always see to it that it will give an opposition to whatever is not of the body, to the force which is trying to come and act upon its vitality. We saw in aphorism 74 how the force which runs the organism makes it revolt in different ways, one better and stronger than the other in order to maintain life. Dr. Hahnemann has explained about the three different type of defensive mechanisms which the vital force uses in the form of psoric, that is the physiological, the psychotic, that is the constructive morphological changes, and then the abnormal or the destructive type of mechanism, which is a syphilitic. And all these are done by the vital force for what purpose? The purpose is to maintain the life for the survival, and that is why the body takes its body revolves in three different type of manners. Again, in aphorism 201, Hahnemann writes, it is evident that man's vital force, when encumbered with chronic disease, adopts a plan. The plan is of developing a local malady on external part, that is the least important part, solely for this object, to thereby silence the internal disease, which otherwise threatens to destroy the vital organs. So here in aphorism 201, our master Dr. Hahnemann explains that when the disease is now converted into a chronic, the maintaining cause which is there is strongly there and the vital force is not able to overcome it, then these kind of chronic diseases start invading our body, and where now the vital force, which is intelligent enough that for its survival it has to make a plan. It adopts a plan that yes, if the whole man has to survive, then some important part and some least important parts are there. So this least important parts can be sacrificed. The disease can prevail there, whereby doing so, the entire body, the entire human vital force is saved and it can go with a better lifestyle. The vital organs which are there are saved, and the least important part of the body, maybe the skin or whichever is there in context to it, will be sacrificed. The disease will go and set in over there so that the other important organs are saved. All the above facts suggest that the vital force or the force which pervades the cell has its own intelligence. This is the point that is very striking, that the doctor within us is always there, which looks and takes care of homeostasis to be maintained into the body. The vital force is really, really understood well in the form of giving it the name of an intelligence. Intelligence in the way that it knows now that when some very strong force is pervading, the body is now going into a chronic kind of a illness. Let's just sacrifice the least important, and the vital organs or the more important organs are to be survived so that a better health and a lifestyle can be lived. Surprisingly, and many homeopaths call the vital force unintelligent. It loses the intelligence in the syphilitic miasm when it loses control and starts sacrificing important organs. That is wherein the destructive tendency and the abnormal kind of the behavior which is now out of the control of the vital force, and that is why known as the syphilitic kind of a trait, sets in, wherein even the important organs are taken away by the disease. This is wherein the autoimmunity strikes in, wherein the vital force or the immunity of the body itself doesn't understand the difference between what is to be saved and what is mine, what is to be kept and what is to be destroyed. So that starts destroying our own vital organs. Herein it says that it loses control and starts sacrificing the important organs. It is only because of its intelligence that the cell and tissues recognize what is harmful to it, what belongs to the internal environment and what does not. What primary steps to be taken, like physiologic defense response, when to change the physiologic defense to morphological defense, what to accumulate, what to produce in excess or what to produce less, or which organ or tissue to destroy. This is never told by anybody to the vital force. The vital force is intelligent enough to understand that to the maintaining cause or whatever trauma is caused, what kind of a reaction the body needs to give so that it can survive and the homeostasis can be maintained well. If only by giving an inflammatory response the body can take care, then it will not go into the second gear. If required, it will then go into the second gear. If required, still it will go into the third gear. So this understanding, this intelligence is already there in the vital force, and it knows very well at the cell level and the tissue level that what kind of a response, what kind of a reaction is needed to give to take away that unrequired energy. That energy which does not belong to the cell or the tissue or the whole being, which is not mine, needs to be thrown away, and that can be done in the three different type of defenses that it takes. Doctors and physicians who try to treat these external SOS signals of the body, like pains, ulcers or eczemas, in fact expose their substandard intellect. These are the people who, with their unintelligent faculties, do not understand the intelligence in the organism. So herein sir is describing that whenever we just observe and we take into consideration only the superficial diseases or the manifestations which are seen, what we are doing by doing so is we forget the entire mechanism which is going on inside the body. The vital force has put this manifestation on a superficial plane or on a organ which is less important. The understanding behind that of the vital force is that I need to save what is more vital, what is more important, and for this the least important organ or the part can be sacrificed. That is shown in the form of pains or ulcers or eczemas, which are there on the superficial parts that are not that important compared to the important vital organs. But a physician who just treats these superficial diseases will, by doing so, give the vital force a chance that it will get suppressed, and now the more important layers or the more important organs will be involved. Sir very clearly states that they are of the substandard intellect and they don't understand the vital force's intelligence by which it is trying to save the whole. And just by treating this superficial manifestations, we are still creating a more difficult task for the vital force, and it will now still go into another grave disease. As if this is not sufficient, the cell, which is a representative unit of the whole man, has been seen to behave and react to different situations, taking into consideration the genetic inheritance. The genetic apparatus, which is at the root of intelligence of the organism, does not only have inherited knowledge and tendency, but is also in an ever-learning process, which imparts acquired traits to array of inherited traits. So it is not only sufficient that we understand that the cell, or which is a representative of the whole man, the basic unit is the cell, which then forms us with tissues and the organ and the system. So these cells represent the basic unit, and when they behave and react to different situations taken into consideration by the genetic inheritance, the genetic code which is there allows a cell and the vital force to understand and behave in a particular fashion. If that response is not sufficient enough, the vital force is still intelligent to change, and it is always into that learning process wherein it will start understanding and accept and develop new traits to fight back, so that the survival of the human being is there. This genetic apparatus, which is at the root of intelligence of the organism, does not only have the inherited knowledge and tendency, but it has always a learning process which imparts different acquired traits. So if one kind of a response does not help the body to overtake the disease, it will get an acquired trait, a different kind of a mechanism, and it will always try to see that the vital force behaves better. This all can happen when the intelligence of the vital force is there and it can take care of it. Thus, the cell or the organism fights physically only with guidance of the mind of the cell. So herein it is very, very clearly understood that there is something called as a mind of the cell, the intelligence of the cell, the intelligence of the human body or the vital force, which is capable enough to take care of its cell. Mind of the cell. Mind of the cell is in its genes. The genes decide whether this individual is going to be a coward, courageous, audacious or timid, angry or anxious, haughty or servile, etc. These and other genetic traits further express themselves through emotions of fear, anxieties, love, attachment, hate, etc. As we know and have already seen that the world of life depends on defense, that is a Darwin's law of survival of the fittest. Defense can be physical or mental, and we saw the cell defending in face of physical attack. Now we'll see how the cell defends the attack mentally. So herein, the mind of the cell is always there into the genes, that genetic code which the human being comes with, that allows the cell to understand and use its intelligence accordingly. That is how we saw that the constitution depends, the soric, the psychotic and the syphilitic constitution, with their genetic code, has that intelligence to understand that what kind of a mechanism or what kind of a defense is required for it to survive. And these genes will then decide at the physical level, but at the mental level as well, that the patient can be a coward or a courageous, audacious or a timid. These are the traits which are genetically seen into the personality. That is the disposition with which the human being is born. And that is why these become one of the strong base in our totality when we are trying to consider to select the simulimum, as it speaks of the genetic code. And that is the mind of the cell that tells us that originally the personality belongs to this kind of a trait, and that will help us to understand and differentiate the remedies when they come very near. We have been seeing the defense on the physical level, and now we will see how the cell defends the attacks mentally. Life has always been busily improving upon the previous generations in qualities and attributes. This is perhaps what Hahnemann has mentioned as striving for the highest purpose of existence. In Aphorism 9 of Organon, Hahnemann says, "In the healthy condition of man, the spiritual vital force, the dynamis that animates the material body, rules with unbounded sway and retains all parts of the organism in admirable, harmonious, vital operation as regards both sensation and functions, so that our indwelling, reason-gifted mind can freely employ this living, healthy instrument for the higher purpose of our existence." Very clearly, our master has given us the motto or the focus that why the survival or why a human being is existing. It is very clearly saying that the vital force which is there into us, which rules with an unbounded sway, and that will retain all parts of the organism in a proper harmonious vital operative homeostasis. When that goes in a proper balanced way, the functions which are occurring in the body, they will occur with the least energy required. And if that happens, whatever the energy extra in this is remaining with us, that helps the human body or the human being to understand and utilize it for the higher purpose of existence. Why are we here is to give the importance, to focus, to understand that human being is not only come here to survive, to stay, eat and finish it off. The intelligence with which we have come, the intellect with which we have come, the our living being itself, our being existing has a very higher purpose. As we see that whenever our basics are fulfilled, then we can think of doing something on a higher level. So the basics of human being or the sense is to remain into harmony, to maintain the homeostasis. Once that is done, then nothing is to be looked ahead over that, and then we can utilize our intellect for the higher purpose of existence. Hahnemann talks about the whole organization of an organism controlled by the vital force or dynamis, and aim of which is to keep the mind and body axis in perfect control. The control of various systems responsible for the continuity of life is to be kept in control, in working condition and in equilibrium. Then and only then, the reason-gifted mind can cause this material body or evolve and change this body for being better and better suited for life. And the higher purpose of life is to change for better and evolve for better and peaceful existence. So herein, our master has very clearly stated that homeopathy is not only for us to take care of the patient's sickness, but when that homeostasis is given to the patient or for the physician himself for that matter, when we remain into that homeostasis, the higher purpose of our existence are taken care of. Our intelligent mind, our intellectual mind is given for the purpose that it can be utilized for more and more growth and evolution of human being and mankind and life. So herein we end the chapter 15, wherein the mind of the cell, the existence of human being or life and the evolvement is explained by Dr. Hahnemann and put forward by Sir, describing to us that we do not here come just to take breaths and go away. There is a lot of another important role, or there are a lot of other focus in life for which our existence and our survival is there. I hope I made the session interesting, and my attempt was fair enough to share the knowledge what Sir has described. Later the further lectures will be continued in the next session by some other physician. Thank you very much for the patient listening.